There was a time when I was handsome. There was a time when I had money to burn. There was a time when where I landed, it was the least of my, it was the least of my concern. But it hurts to lean back in handcuffs, like nine kinds of shame turned to rage. As a younger man, I might have put up a fight, but I just feel like such a fool at my age. Some of this trouble just finds me. No matter where I turn, how do you know when it's too late? How do you know when it's too late? How do you know when it's too late? Too late? You know the number one symptom of heart disease? The number one symptom of heart disease is sudden death. It's like time stands still forever till it starts shaking around on you. It starts shaking around like some crazy old hooker on meth. And you know me, I can't take no preaching. Not on Sunday and no other day. But I feel like I ought to be praying or something. And I have no idea what I'd say. I'd say some of this trouble just finds me. Most of this trouble I earn. How do you know when it's too late? How do you nothing out here on this highway, but I have been passed by, and I have passed by more than my share of cars. And I do remember back in my younger days when I was so certain that driving even faster was what was gonna get me far. So there ain't nothing left for me to learn here. It's just this half full, a half empty cup, less than an ounce. Possession shit. I could do that kind of time standing up. Some of this trouble just finds me. Can you hear me? Can you hear me up there? This ain't working. This ain't on. Is this thing working? Is this thing on? In the hallway of a high school, anywhere USA, there was a bully that would pick on a different kid. It seemed like every day, a pack of back slapping buddies laughing and backing him all the way. His screaming girlfriend make him believe in everything he'd say. Is this thing working? Is this thing working? Is this thing working? And then And one day some kid who he beat up a couple times before realized to even his surprise he probably could indeed take more. And with that he hatched the evil plan, he gonna make that devil pay. He walked up to him in the middle of the gym and he found the nerve to say, he said, "You gonna hit somebody? You wanna hit me too? In fact, you're gonna hit me every day because now I'm picking on you. And as crazy as this might sound right now, I ain't stopping until I get through. It's too late to beg for mercy. There ain't nothing that you can do. Is it this thing? Is this thing? Is this thing working? Is this thing?" Well, that bully, he just laughed and laughed, of course. So did all of his friends. And he beat that kid unmercifully for days and days on end. Only slightly less impressively to that girl and all of his friends, who would eventually secretly start hoping that the kid might win. Is this thing working? Is this thing working? Is this thing working? Is this thing working? Cost our bully the war a long time ago. And of all the scars that he got to show for every blow that kid sneaks in, the worst one's knowing that tomorrow he's gonna have to get up and fight that kid again. Is this thing working? Is this thing working? Is this thing on? Is this thing working? Is this thing on? Is this thing working? Just like old time. Well, there's a Coke machine glowing through a parking lot. Call that a room with a view. This was the best night of pool that I ever shot. I made a lot of money too. Looking for some company in the weekly scene. I seen an ad that just had to be you. Hadn't seen you since New Orleans. Never did figure out where you'd run off to. I know you looked bad last time you saw me. Believe me, I've been doing all right. I won a tournament last week in Oklahoma City. Hustled half of this town tonight. I got some cocaine if you want some. It's the best I could find. Here we could just sit here and talk all night. If that big old guy out in your car don't mind like the old time. Screw off a top on a bottle of wine. We're living on our own kind of American dream. It's just like old time. Your goal was always the same as mine. You didn't want to throw your fishing line in that old main street. No, I ain't expecting anybody but you. I don't know who that could be at the door. But I'm pretty sure that you've got a clue. And I'll bet you've been to this hotel before. Put the you-know-what in the bathroom. But don't flush it down just yet. I put your pager in my suitcase. I'll get the window. You light a cigarette. It'll be like old time. Just like the old time. Living out our own kind of American dream. It's just like old time. Your goal was always the same as mine. You didn't want to throw your fishing line in that old main street. No, sir, officer, you don't understand. We're just two old friends drinking wine. I'm sure she is, but that's not all she is. She's also an old friend of mine. I got a high school picture right here in my wallet, 1982. No, sir, officer, no offense taken. You have a good night, too. It's a good thing we didn't throw this away. Baby, turn up the radio. I'm pretty sure those cops knew what we were up to. I guess they just decided to let us go. Oh, don't make such a thing about that picture. That was just something I kept. Hey, don't get all sentimental on me now, girl. You haven't even told me what your new name is. Yeah, it's like old time. Just like the old times, we're living on our own kind of American dream. It's just like old times. Your goal was always the same as mine. You didn't want to throw your fishing line in that old mainstream. And you didn't, did you? Portion of the program without thanking Mr. Polk for inviting us to play at his fabulous theater this evening. How many of y'all have ever seen me play before? Well, thank you for coming back, and don't stop me if you've heard this. This is for that friend you dragged out. If you never heard me play before, my name's Todd Snider. I've been driving around this great country of ours for almost 15 years now. I make this shit up. I sing it for anybody that will listen to it. Some of the songs are sad. Some of them are funny. Some of them are short. Some will seem like they go on for as many as 18 minutes. And sometimes I may talk for as many as 18 minutes in between a particular song. Unless it's Alpha Males Get In Free Night, and then I just plow through this shit while two or three of you yell stuff at me in between. Which is fine, too. I should also warn you that I might share some of my opinions with you over the course of the show tonight. I'd like to let people know before we go too far into the show that while I may share my opinions with you, I don't share them with you because I think they're smart or because I think you need to know them. I share them with you because they rhyme. I didn't come down here to change any of y'all's minds about anything. I'll come down here to ease my own mind about everything. And so with that said, I want to thank all of y'all, so many of y'all, for coming down here and giving me a chance to do this with you. If everything goes well, we can expect a 90-minute distraction from our doom. And remember, if you're really nice to me, maybe later I'll tell you about the time Tony Bennett stole $65 from me. For now, though, I would like to play for you a song that I play when I'm feeling really relaxed. Tension. Tension. Tension is all that I know. Whoa. I've got tension in my health food. Got tension in my exercise. I got tension and it's everywhere that I go. After the bad guy killed off all the underdeveloped characters, the good guy put a bullet right through his head. And the screenwriter stood up and he told us that all the loose ends had been tied. He said, justice is irrelevant. Violent problems need violent solutions. Because in America, we like our bad guys dead. Preferably after some kind of kick-ass car chase or something. Tension is all that I know. I got tension out in traffic. I got tension in my office. I've got tension and it's everywhere that I go. Oh. Well, they roped off all of my problems and they pointed their fingers at drug addiction. I think it's because they know if you're the one doing the pointing, nobody's looking at you. But you know, this war on drugs is funded by a tobacco and alcohol commission. It's not really what drugs that you're strung out on they care about so much as whose. People still dig drugs. Shit. I live in East Nashville. Smells like a skunk farm over there. Tension is all that I know. Oh, I got tension in my courthouse, tension in my White House. I've got tension that is everywhere that I go. When rock and roll first came around, seemed like preachers all went crazy. Pretty soon, though, that wasn't enough to get anybody in the door. So now, they jump on just about any scandal that they have to try and save me, because they know that I don't buy that bullshit about the devil's music anymore. Gay people getting married. Ooh. That's what scares people that don't have shit all else to be scared of these days. Tension is all that I know. I got tension in my traffic, got tension in my office, I've got tension in it's everywhere that I go. And I go, yeah, I go. Tell y'all a story. It's only gonna take a few minutes. I'll do it before we get too into that. Everybody's dancing and everything. You might have heard me. I've been telling this story for years, so you might have heard me tell it before. If you did hear me tell it before, and I tell it this time and some of the facts are different, I want to apologize in advance. Unless, of course, you were hoping for that, and then that's just a little something I threw in extra. This will make the song make more sense, or I wouldn't bother you with it. I couldn't make the whole song rhyme, so I gotta tell you part of it. This story takes me way back to 1985 in Portland, Oregon. I was at a party, and these people were talking about California, and this guy named Rob said, you know, I think I'm gonna get in my car and drive to California right now and start my life over. And I thought, that's the best fucking idea I've ever heard. Can I go? So me and him get in this car, drive 16 hours down to San Francisco. A month later, I'm still there, living on what I like to call the sofa circuit, where you don't have a house or a job or nothing, but at the end of every party, you're that guy that wakes up in their house. That worked for me for a long time, a few months, man, I made that work. Then I got to where I was down to about one sofa that they would let me have. My brother was living in Austin on these other guy's sofa at the time. So I called him and I asked him, do they have a second sofa that maybe I could stay on? He said that they did. And I still am grateful to this. He sent me a plane ticket. So I got some people to give me a ride. I got my bag with my clothes and my bag with my albums. I go and I get my ticket and they tell me that I can only bring one of the bags. So I show up in Austin with nothing but the shirt on my back and my album. I get off the plane and I go out. I'm waiting for my brother and this car pulls up and this guy says, are you Todd? And I said, yeah. He says, get in. And I thought, well, this isn't my brother, but where else? I got no other ride. He had my first name. So I get in the car. We start driving to where he says my brother is, right? So we drive for a while and we get to this apartment and I walk in. The first thing I notice in this apartment is that that my brother's not there and that they only have one sofa. So if this is the apartment that I'm supposed to be staying in, they don't have a second sofa. And just as that was starting to bum me out, these guys all said, we're going to a party. Well, I like to party. So I go with them in this car and we drive over to this house. And we're sitting in someone's house, everybody's drinking beer, and there's this like 6'9" guy leaning against the wall, huge as shit, girls surrounding him. Yeah, and he's telling these jokes. I like girls and I like to laugh, so I stand over there. I'm enjoying the party, and pretty soon I get to talking to Trog and some of his friends. And I turned, that's what everybody called him, Trog. That was his name, Trog. 6'9", I swear he was 300 pounds. And everybody's laughing his jokes. I'm talking to some of his friends. Turns out they do have a sofa that nobody's staying on. So I go over there and I stay with them for say 3 months, I guess it was. And every night we would get together and we would listen to whatever music Trog wanted to listen to or watch whatever TV shows he wanted to watch. And we'd all just sort of be his posse, I guess is what the kids call it, you know? And then one night he plays this record by a guy named Jerry Jeff Walker. Have you ever heard of him? He's one of my main favorites. I'd never heard of him to that time, but he wrote Mr. Bojangles. A lot of people know that. Pissing in the Wind. A lot of other sensitive shit like that. So I'm immediately infatuated with this Jerry Jeff Walker. I love him. Turns out they tell us that he's going to be playing at this place called Green Hall. So me and Trog and a bunch of my buddies, we go down to this place and we see Jerry Jeff Walker play. He's up there standing kind of like me, just playing a guitar and singing stuff and mostly just playing at the top like this, you know, the few chords and never really goes down. He doesn't do this, you know. And I'm watching him, shit, I could do that, you know. So the next day I go out and I go to a pawn shop and I get a guitar and I start following Jerry Jeff Walker around and watching him play. And I'm singing, playing these little chords up here and I buy all his records. And I learn from, if you're like me, when you buy a record, I like to read the liner notes. And so I read in the liner notes that this guy, he doesn't come to Nashville to make his records. He makes all the people from Nashville bring all their equipment to this bar and that he likes in a town called Luckenbach, Texas. I think that's the smartest fucking thing I've heard since going to California and changing my life. So I find out where this bar is in Luckenbach and I make it my dream in life to play at this bar. And I made a tape of some songs I made up and I sent it to this bar in Luckenbach and nobody called me back. And then a few months later, we're sitting around watching whatever Trog wants to watch on TV. And we get this call, and it's Large Marge from Luckenbach. And she says that the act from this weekend canceled, and could you come down and do this? And I'm like, so excited to do it. I check with Trog, he says we can do it. We all get into the car. That Saturday, we get in this old Celica I have, and we start driving out to find Luckenbach, Texas. Now, if you've never been there, you're not gonna fucking go. Because tourists take the signs that point to it to hang in the garage because of Willie and Waylon and the boys, I guess. So if you're out on the Devil's Backbone Highway, you can't find this fucking thing. So me and these guys, we're driving around on this thing called the Devil's Backbone Highway. We finally give up. We pull into this bar, uniquely named the Devil's Backbone Tavern, and they all decide I gotta go in and find directions, right? So I go in, and there's like tops 17 teeth in the whole place, maybe 50 people, right? I'm terrified. I look behind the bar and there's this old lady behind the bar, hunched over, reminds me of my grandma a little bit, and I think, I could probably take her, you know? So I go over and I ask her, I say, we're from Austin, we're trying to find Luckenbach, and we're so lost, and we don't know where we're going. And she turns around real slow, reminding me of my grandma a little, and she turns around and she says, fuck Luke and Bob. Drink with us. So we did. And by the end of the night, we had our guitars out, and we'd been drinking all these beers, and I was singing all these songs. And by the end of the night, I get up to, everybody called her Miss Virgie. That was what they called us. I said, Miss Virgie, how much do I owe you for all these beers? And she said, you don't know me shit, boy. So I started going there every Friday after that and singing my songs in the corner of the bar. And about... one of the first gigs I ever had, really. And I still think fondly on it to this day. And I knew that I was probably going to make up a song about Miss Virgie someday. A few years later, when I was living on the floor of the girls' dorm at Rhodes College in Memphis, Tennessee, I made up this song about Miss Virgie. And it features the hottest guitar lick in captivity. Song out to Miss Virgie and her family wherever they are tonight. Oh, Miss Virgie tended bar at a shack out in the hill. And never made her no money, boy, but it paid up all of her bills. She must have been 80 years old. Her heart was warm, her beer was cold. She gave away more than she ever sold. And she'd be smiling all the time. I used to sing off in the corner every Friday night to a loud crowd of cowboys, bikers and barroom fights. They'd be drinking beer and carrying on. None of them had listened to one of my songs. So old Miss Virgie, she'd be singing along. She said she knew them all by heart. And then one night after closing, she poured me up a beer. She said, come over here and sit down, you little shit. I got something that you need to hear. Life isn't easy getting through. Everybody gonna make things tough on you. But I can tell you right now, if you dig what you do, they will never get you down. Love said life's too short to worry. Life's too long to wait. But it's too short not to love everybody. Life's too long to hate. A lot of men haggle and finagle all the time, trying to save a nickel, maybe make it down. And I ain't bored, no siree. I say I ain't got the time. Yodely. Old Virgie, I guess it's probably been about 15 years. I've been bumming around this country. I sing my songs for tips and beer. Now the nights are long, the driving's tough, the hotels are weird and the pay sucks. But I can't dig what I do enough. Lord, it never ever gets me down. All I can say, life's too short to worry. Life's too long to wait. But it's too short not to love everybody. Life's too long to hate. Men haggling for the hell all the time, trying to save a nigga, maybe make it down. Not me, boy, no siree. I ain't got the time to look. Technically, that's the end of the song. But before I let go of it, I was wanting to explain to you the hottest guitar lick in captivity. So I played there that whole summer, and there was this one old guy that came to every single show I did. He sat in the corner, hogged about four teeth all to himself. And one night towards the end of the summer, he come up to me and he said, man, I've been watching you. And before he could finish, I interrupted him. I said, I've noticed you over there, and I've been meaning to say thank you. I'm a little shy. I didn't mean. He said, oh, don't thank me, boy. I think you suck. And I understood what he meant when he said that, but he wanted to go on and on about it. He said that him and his brothers were big fans of Eddie Van Halen and the Eddie Van Halen Band. And he said how last summer him and his brothers had gone into Austin to see Eddie Van Halen and the Eddie Van Halen Band. And the whole concert, man, Eddie V was up on the top of the guitar like this. Woo, 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 woo. And the whole time you've been playing, you stand up there, play three chords. I think it sucks. So, when I made up this song, of course I thought of old Miss Virgie. Of course I thought of Jerry Jeff Walker. Of course I thought of my buddy Trog. Willie and Waylon and the boys. But mostly, thought about that guy and his brother. That's when I come up with this part. Eat your heart out, you inbred son of a bitch. Doc Ellis didn't think he was pitching that day back in 1970 when he and his wife took a trip to the ballpark a little bit differently. So by the time that he hit the bullpen, half the world had melted away. Now that's about the time Coach Murtaugh came and said, Doc, you're pitching today. But taking the mound, the ground turned into the icing on a birthday cake. That leadoff man came up and turned into a dancing rattlesnake. That crowd tracked back and forth in waves of color underneath the sun. That ball turned into a silver bullet, his arm into a gun. I took a look all around the world one time. I finally discovered you can't judge a bird. Straight innings in a 0-0 tie. As all them batters' names come ringing from a voice out of the sky. Hallucinating Halloween scenes, each new swing of the bat. His sinker looked like it was falling off a table, but nobody was hallucinating that. I took a look all around the world one time. I finally discovered you can't judge a book. The seventh, he was up one to nothing and giving them Padres fits. And by the bottom of the eighth, he was up two to nothing and they still hadn't got any hits. With 1 hour left to go in the game, the batter looked like a baby child. That birthday cake was shaking, them waves of color was going wild. Was high as he had ever been, laughing to the sound of the world going round, completely unaware of the wind. And while the papers would say he was scattered that day, he was pretty as a pitcher could be. The day Doc Ellis of the Pittsburgh Pirates threw a no-hitter on LSD. All around the world. Thank you. y'all feel like singing a little? They named that goddamn kiss-ass handleman vice president of human resources or something. He stood up and made a speech about how we would all have to work even harder now. I thought, harder now? Harder at what? I'd give anything to get up and walk out of here, but I'm stuck on the corner. Sanity and madness. Looking them over. Can't see a difference. Making money out of paper, paper out of trees. Making so much money we can hardly breathe. You ought to hear the shit that I get from my daughter. She says she can't stand the sight of the car I bought her. It's gonna ruin her life forever. She don't ride a ragtop. Her and her mother spend my money pretty much nonstop. They're trying to break me for the sake of this neighborhood. They want everybody up and down the street to think we're doing good. We're stuck on the corner. Sanity and madness. Looking them over, can't see a difference. Making money out of paper, paper out of trees. We're making so much money we can hardly breathe. I didn't even want to study economics. My parents made me because they said it would be practical. I can't make my kid do a goddamn thing I tell him to. That kid's an unrepentant radical. He is as unimpressed by all these plaques in my cubicle as I'm secretly impressed with his ability to look at everything so completely irresponsibly. I'm stuck on the corner. Sanity and madness. Looking them over. Can't see a difference. Making money out of paper, paper out of trees. We're making so much money we can hardly breathe. Got to call that little pecker Mr. Handelman. Drove home from work as mad as I had ever been. And then I nearly jerked the kid out of a drive-thru window. He said, will that be everything? I said, what would you know? You're looking at a man about to buy his kid a ragtop. What are you driving? A bicycle, you little punk. I'm stuck on the corner. Sanity and madness. Looking him over. Can't see a difference. Paper, paper out of trees. We're making so much money we can hardly breathe. So far. You sound like you're singing good. Let's see how you whistle. Wait till it comes around. Edge of a building, I'm watching the traffic below. Drinking a beer, thinking of jumping, not far from ready to go. Below me the crowd slowly gathers around, cop cars with news cameras too. I can't get out of this pain that I'm in. I don't know what else to do. Sometimes I feel like I'm so uninvited, like something so out of touch. They tell me depression runs in our family. That doesn't help me much. Crowds yelling jump over a cop on a bullhorn. It's making him kind of hard to hear. He's yelling something about having so much to live for. I'm almost through with this beer. Squinting my eyes to see through the sunlight. This crowd's even bigger now. There's no point in wondering what afterlife's like. Don't matter anyhow. We're already in hell, as far as I can tell. Just listen to these people scream. This feels like a rally in a high school field house. I feel like the captain of a team. Well, here goes the captain of your team. Follow the light to the Garden of Eden. Stand at the pearly gate. St. Peter comes over, puts his hand on my shoulder. He's telling me that I've got to wait. Comes over, puts his hand on my shoulder, he's telling me I gotta wait. He says, you know, you can't kill yourself and still expect to come in here, kid, but you look like a victim of circumstance, so I'm just gonna break every bone in your body and give you another chance. Slowly looking around me, it's this lonely recovery room. But closing my eyes, I can see a new sunrise over acres of flowers in bloom. I don't know when it will be, but the next time you see me, I'll be tapping to a whole new beat. Walking souls into the holes of my shoes down the sunny side of some street. Sunshine. Thank you. Thank you very much. You having a good time so far? I'm having a great time. Even though that Jimi Hendrix part in the middle of that. We planned that. Hey, is it all right if I tell you one more story? And then I'll play whatever you want. Hang on. It's not the boss me around part yet. Let me just get this right. I wanted to play you, how about the Great American Taxi, man? These are my brothers of another mother from Boulder, Colorado. It's the third band I've actually been the singer of. But before that, you might remember, I used to come to town with a band called the Nervous Wrecks. And then before that, I was in a band that I was initially was supposed to be just the rhythm guitar player, but I ended up getting to be the lead singer of that, and that group too. And to me, that's one of it's one of those classic show business stories about being in the right place at the right time. So I wanted to tell that story to you now, if that's all right. It'll only take about an hour. Is that good? I was living in Memphis, Tennessee at the time. It was about 1993. And I was playing around in the bars making my living, and I just got a record contract, which was very exciting to me, the idea that I would be able to make songs in the studio and all that. But the only hitch was that the record company, they told me they didn't want me to play any more shows in Memphis until the record came out, and that way when the record came out, we could have a big show. But I made my living playing in these bars, and I'd already blown my advance. And so I wasn't sure what I was supposed to do. So I called him up and I said, hey man, you know, I don't know how to keep my lights on or eat food or anything if I don't play in the bars of Memphis. And I remember it was Bob Mercer, he's still a friend of mine, he was in charge. He says, the album's gonna change your life, son. And I said, yeah, but what about till then? And he said, seriously, the record's gonna change your life. So I didn't bring it up again. And I went back home and I started thinking, how am I going to make a living, man? So I got this idea and I called him up and I said, what if I join another band that I'm not the singer of? They don't say my name. That's not going to impact our show. And they said, okay, that's a good idea. So I got in the paper and I saw an audition for a guy to play rhythm guitar in a country band. And they needed a bass player and they needed an acoustic guitar player. So me and my friend who played bass, we went in, we auditioned, and it was a band that was going to play the current country hits of the day. And they were called KK Rider. And the singer's name was KK. And he had this kick-ass hat, and he had this white leather jacket with tassels that hung down on the side. And when he'd sing, he'd close his eyes, and he'd look and lean into it. And I get the gig, but I'm the rhythm guitar player, so I wouldn't be standing here. I'd be like back here and over here. That'd be my spot, say, right? So I'm standing over there in this group. And now, the story I wanted to tell you about is how I got to be the singer, which is a classic show business story about being in the right place at the right time. We were playing a pool hall in Memphis, Tennessee, and the pool hall had a gimmick where they had a rope swing that hung down from the short ceiling of the bar, red velvet rope swing, and if you lofted up gently on this swing, there was a bell attached to the ceiling and another bell behind it attached to the ceiling. And every once in a while, a cute little girl in a short skirt would come out, get up on this thing, loft up gently, touch the bell, loft back gently, touch the other bell, and the crowd would go crazy because that meant drinks were half price, so there was some sort of special going on until this happened again. And I'd be standing over here, you know. And the swing went back and towards us, you know. So it'd be this girl coming towards us and then back away from us. And I remember on this particular occasion, the band we were playing, that Jerry Jeff, I mentioned him earlier, we're playing, actually Rusty Weir, God rest his soul, wrote this. We were playing, don't it make you want to dance? Don't it make you want to smile? And you all know that one? When you're down, down, down in the country picking sing. So KK Rider got his eyes closed. He's leaning into it. His tassels are flaring in the wind. I'm standing over here holding down the rhythm. He's singing his song. This cute little girl gets up, lofts, gently touches the bell, lofts back, touches the other bell. Crowd goes great, half price drinks. We're all having a good time. I'm standing over there playing rhythm. KK's got his tassel swinging. He's singing a Rusty Weir song. Now, here's the funny part. After the girl gets down, a whole other girl, real skinny looking little Southern girl in a 38 special t-shirt, she gets up on the swing. And she starts swinging back and forth. And I can tell right away by her age and by what she has on that she doesn't impact the drink specials at all. She's just doing this. And KK Ryder's got his eyes closed and he's singing. And I'm over here. I'm watching this girl. And she's swinging back and forth. And I'm wondering if she's supposed to be doing it. But just as I wonder, I can tell that she's not, because the owner of the bar comes flying out from behind the bar. For what I'm imagining are insurance reasons, and he's like, she can't do that. Now, just as he says that she can't do this, her old man stands up, and he's pissed, and he's got a 38 special t-shirt on, too. Different tour, same band. He stands up, and he gets in front of the owner of the bar as the bar owner's trying to tell her that she can't be on this swing, and he's probably thinking, I paid a cover, I'll swing on any goddamn thing I want to in here. He stands up and he sticks his chest out. The owner, you know how guys, the girls don't do this, but guys stick their chests out. You know how they bounce their chests off each other? That means they're upset, I guess. I'm not sure, I don't understand it, but that's where it's at. They're pressing their chests against each other, and they're yelling at each other, and they're not paying attention to her. And she has already lofted up gently and hit one bell, and lofted up gently. She's beyond the lofting and the gently. She's still kicking her legs back and forth like she's on a swing in the park, and she's picking up fucking speed. And they're arguing about whether or not she should be up there, and I'm standing over here like, KK Ryder's got his tassels in the wind. He's got his eyes closed. He's singing that Rusty Weir song with all that he has inside of himself. And this girl is picking up speed. And these two guys are arguing. And I swear to God, at some point, it's just going bing, 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 bing. And she's clearly injuring herself. Everybody paying attention knows this at this point, except for these two guys. And then the boyfriend turns around and looks up and he sees, my girlfriend's clearly hurting herself. He does the dumbest fucking thing he does the whole night. Well, wait a minute. I don't know where they went afterwards. So he did the dumbest thing that I saw him do the whole night. He turns around, and as God is my witness, he grabs this rope to stop his girlfriend. Abruptly grabs it. She comes flying out of it like a catapult towards us. KK Ryder's got his tassel swinging, his eyes closed, his hat on, he's singing with all his heart. I'm standing over here playing rhythm guitar. Here she comes right at us, man. And I wouldn't make this up, and who would? She lands right in front of these monitors, right between the monitors and the microphone stand. The microphone stand goes this way, back that way, like James Brown trick, and then hits KK Ryder right in the chips. Boom! Hits him right in the mouth, and he's out like a light. And he goes down this way, and he's laying this way. I'm pretty sure this chick was unconscious as she was coming towards us, but she's as unconscious as well, and she's laying this way. So they're forming a T. The microphone has corrected itself, and it's still standing there. She's unconscious this way, he's unconscious this way. I'm standing over here. And I'm thinking to myself, I know the words to this one. One of them classic show business success stories about being in the right place at the right time. Don't it make you want to dance? Don't it make you want to smile? When you're down, down, down in the country picking single wire. Don't it make you want to dance? Don't it make you want to smile? When you're down, down, down in the country picking single wire. friends and people I wanna see. It's like a rainbow in the sky, the certain twinkle in everybody's eye. They're telling me they believe in what I am and what I wanna be. Don't it make one dance? Don't it make one smile? When you're down, down, down in the country, pick and sing wild. Don't it make one dance? Don't it in my wallet of you, ring on my finger, tattoo too. I tell you, baby, what I wanna do. Bring 'em home, bring 'em home, bring 'em home. Bring 'em home, bring 'em home, bring 'em home. I've seen some things you gonna see on my face. I'm making memories I won't never erase. I'm gonna have to bring the memories with me out of this place. Bring 'em home, bring 'em home, bring 'em home. Bring 'em home, bring 'em home, bring 'em home. enlisted like a lot of guys do, hoping to maybe get a leg up on a dream or two. Now it seems like all I'm ever almost dying to do is bring them home, bring them home, bring them home to you. Going home, bringing home would be a dream. They were hoping they heard if they drove all the way out tonight. Which one? The D.B. Cooper was 43 when we first heard his name. 47 miles away from where he fell down to his fame. But he told me that the hardest part wasn't really jumping out of that plane. It was spending the night watching police lights shine down through the pouring rain. They had a man hunting that next morning like nothing I'd ever seen. I was only 8 years old at the time. I was watching on the TV screen. They were saying they were never gonna make it now. Shining those lights back down on that mountain again. Not far away from the city of roses, they all watch those lights up to red. D.B. Cooper. Blocked off all the exit roads. They had to turn loose all of their hounds. They even dragged the river up a couple of times to see if he had drowned. With all those men working overtime, they swore they would bring him down. But a parachute and a few $100 is all that they've ever found. Not far away from the city of roses, they all watch those lights up to red. Some people say that he died up there somewhere in the rain and the wind. Other people say that he got away, but then his girlfriend did him in. Lawmen say if he is out there someday, they're gonna drag him in. As for me, I hope they never see old D.B. Cooper again. Not far away from the city of Rome. He tried to look like he had a little bit of money. Drifted with a southern drawl. Well, I could tell right away by the way he was running that that boy was just begging to crawl. At least a junkie knows what he needs. You get a man all strung out on greed, he'll give up everything he's got for just one shot at having it all. He's taking every last cent of his savings on a trip down a local track. He had a tip from a friend, but he fell down the wind on a horse named Heart Attack. Well, that ain't no fool, but he didn't bet at all. So everything was cool, and that horse took a fall. But then he turned around and blew the race trying to win it back. Too tough. Wish he figured by the money he been throwing around that he's damn sure good looking enough. So she worked her way over, she shot him a wink, he took his last $5. He bought her a drink. By the time they hit a motel six, they figured they was in love. Stop. You believe this? He gonna let both of us in. So they took all the savings out of the bank. On the way home, they stopped to gas up her tank. She said, in for some cigs, and she never thought I'd start working. They wanted easy Monday. Sad, but it's true. Steam and it. Well, just the other morning, I was hanging around in my house. I had that new book with all those pictures of Gary Allen naked in it. I was checking it out. Just then a friend of mine came through the door. Said she'd never pegged me for a scumbag before. Said she didn't ever want to see me anymore. And I still don't know. Vinny over here smokes a lot of dope. It ain't like we went on TV like Sinead O'Connor did that time and tore up pictures of Pope. I know I get wild, I know I get drunk. Ain't like I've got a bunch of bodies in my trunk. The old man used to call me a no good punk, and I still don't know. Just the other morning, you know, these cops pulled me over outside of a bar. They turned on their lights and they said, "Hey, old timer, we're gonna have to ask you to step out of the car." I was only kidding when I called them a couple of dicks. Still, they made me do the stupid human tricks. Now I'm stuck in this jail with a bunch of dumb hicks, and I still don't know. Thank you all so much. I'm having a great time. I hope that you're having a good time. I hope you're hearing the song you hope you heard. I want to do this for all my neighbors over there in East Nashville. Sidewalk, like he owned the whole downtown. Hearing him talking to some chick through a thick ghost of smoke, through a thicker haze of southern comfort and cold. Say, girl, you're hotter than the hinges hanging off the gates of hell. Don't be afraid to turn to me, baby, if he don't treat you well. And by he meant me, so I laughed and I shook his head. He laughed a little bit louder as he would yell up at the band. They trade song, pour me one more round. Make him lay my boots on day, lay me down. I am a runaway locomotive on a one-track mind. And I'm looking for any kind of trouble I can't find. I got this old black leather jacket, got this pack of Marlboro Red. Got this stash here in my pocket, got these thoughts in my own head. The right to run till I gotta walk, till I've gotta crawl. Got this moment we're all in right now, and nothing else at all. Play a train song, hold me one more round. Make a lean my boots on all day to lay me down. I am a runaway locomotive out of one track mind. Television blizzard lights, we looked around his place, found him cold there on his sofa. He had this little smile across his face, and though I tried with all my sadness, smile I could never be. A poor man who looked to me like he died laughing in his sleep, singing his favorite song, drinking one last round. Made him leave his boots on the day they laid him down. He was a wrong way locomotive out of his one track mind. A blade train song, blade train song, blade train. take two or three blocks from here. They pull these kids over for driving while African, and the ones that got a warrant always running fear. I sit here waiting for the coast to clear, but wishing once again I had a gun around here. Turn on my news and what do I hear? Some kid shot the bank up on Gallatin Road. Ran away from the cops while he's trying to reload. He beat them up to Eastland Street on feet, and now he's probably reloaded and running down my street. I better turn my alarm on and lock myself in. Helicopter's over my house again sometime. Devil, you know. This poor kid probably never had a chance to give a fuck. He wouldn't know good luck from a debutante. He gotta find a way to be Steve McNair, a young buck, or his tough luck looking for a prison to haunt. And you can forget getting any job you want, unless you really wanna work in a fast food restaurant. And who wants to do that? Do you wanna do that? I wouldn't trade that for my cooking hat, or my gang, or my gun, or my waist full of pagers, for a job deep frying shit for richer teenagers. If that's where it's at, then no one's gonna help. How are you gonna blame a kid from helping himself? There's a war going on, the poor can't win. Helicopter's over on my house. This kid is gonna get very far unless he finds a way to make it back over to Berry Street, and he can't do that unless he steals a car. The way things are, they don't seem right. It's always white people talking about some hope and light. There ain't no hope in Sam Levy, there's just guns and drugs. We ain't building bridges, we're just training thugs. Then I hear this terrifying kick at my back door. In walks this kid, I say, hey, I seen this kid before. I see him all the time at that bar on Woodland Street. Now he's bleeding in my kitchen, tracking blood off his feet. And he's looking at me like I'll either help him or die, till he sees in my eyes that I'm on his side. I hand him my keys, I say, you better move fast. There's a J in my ashtray and plenty of gas. He throws me the cash, he says, I'll be back for this. I say, yeah, well, don't be surprised if there's a little bit of it missing. His gold teeth glisten with a big old grin. He says, we'll talk about that when I see you again. He shook my head, he shook his back. I felt like I was about to have a heart attack. Till they finally drove away, I thought, God damn, helicopter's over my house again.
window. Kingsmen came together in a garage. They could hardly even play, but they practiced night and day. Pretty soon they got to where they could really play that song Louie Louie. So they saved up all the money from their shows. They went into a studio and they gave their version of that song Louie Louie a try. Now, I don't know the words to that song Louie Louie, and I'm pretty sure that the singer for the Kingsmen didn't know them either. If he did know them, he didn't get them right on the record. Because on the record, they sound completely jumbled in his jaw. He says, "Me think of me girl, oh so constantly. Ah, may I make her Well, last part scared everybody from the PTA to the FBI. See, kids have been going kind of crazy lately. Seemed like nobody could figure out why. So they decided to launch an investigation with a coalition. At least had to try to figure out the words to that song, Louie Louie. It's the feel good hit of this endless summer. It gets kids out of control. Singing along to that star-spangled bummer. Hail, hail. You know that Marilyn Manson? His real name's not Marilyn Manson. He's a skinny public high school kid from Ohio. He's not some monster from out of this world. And like a lot of skinny public high school kids, he was sick of getting beaten up by the pulling guard all week, only to go out on the weekend and watch the quarterback get all the girls. So he formed a band, man. And now, Marilyn Manson, he gets a lot of chicks. They're weird chicks, but they're chicks. A few years later, a couple latchkey kids go tragically mad. Everybody's gathered around the television store over at the mall trying to figure out what went wrong. This guy says, "You think the life of a kid going to school around here could have got that bad?" And this other guy said, "No, probably just the words to one of them goddamn Marilyn Manson songs. You know which one I'm talking about." It's the feel-good hit of this endless summer. It gets the kids out of control. Singing on to that star-spangled bummer. Hail, hail, rock and roll. Every 10 years or so, our country and some other little country, we start firing all of our newest weapons at each other. For some reason or another, right or wrong, like it or not, it happens. And when it happens, people get shot. And when people get shot, they show that on television a lot. Every night at 6 o'clock. And you don't have to be 18 to see that. You don't even have to be in first grade. First grade, where they will teach a kid the pride that they tell him he gonna need to thrive in a world where they say that only the strong are gonna survive. So he's taught the art of more to compare to and to keep score. Monday through Friday, while he stares at the floor, till Sunday, they make him go to school once more. Only this time, they make him wear a suit and a tie and listen to some guy who claims to know where people go when they die. Then only the meek are gonna inherit the earth. Well, shit. By this time, how could anybody's kid know what anything was worth? Now, brothers and sisters of Nashville, I'm only one guy. I don't even need know the word to that song, Louie Louie. I can tell you right now, without batting an eye, that the next time some latchkey kid goes wrong, it ain't gonna be because the words to some Bear Jr. song or anything like that. I ain't trying to preach to you either, brothers and sisters. I'm just trying to string a few words together too. Hey, kids. Let's get on. Let's get it on. Let's get it on. Conservative Christian, right-wing Republican, straight white American man. Soul-saving, flag-waving, rush-loving, land-paving, personal friends to the quail. Shirt-tucking, frat-housing, kick-tapping, back-slapping, hater of hippies like me. Tree-hugging, peace-loving, pot smoking, porn watching, lazy ass hippies like me. Tree hugging, peace loving, pro choice and gay wedding, great American taxi digging hippies like me. Skin color blinded, conspiracy minded, protesters of corporate greed. We who have nothing, and most likely will till we all end up locked up in jail. By conservative Christian, right-wing Republican, straight white American male. Diamonds and dogs, boys and girls, we're living together in two separate worlds. Following leaders of of shame, looking for someone to blame. I know who I like to blame. Conservative Christian, right wing Republican, straight white American males. Gay fashion, black fearing, war fighting, tree killing, regional leaders. So hard to keep the free reins of this democracy. From tree hugging, peace loving, pot smoking, porn watching, lazy ass hippies like me. Tree hugging, peace loving, pot smoking, porn watching, lazy ass hippies like me. Tree hugging, peace loving. you so much. Have you had a good time so far? I sure hope so. I know that we've been working hard for you, and I know that we've had a great time. I can at least speak for myself and tell you that I've had a great time. How about the Great American Taxi? I can tell you right now, I always have a good time out there. Okay. I know all that shit. It's all right if I play you this one, though. I have this one on my mind. All right. This is fun, man. This part's fun, too. You know, I have a lot of my friends, they'll be like, God, they just yelled at me the whole fucking time. I'm like, what's so unfun about that? You know, in fact, I'll tell you this. Every single time, I'm having a great time. I appreciate y'all being so nice to me and singing these songs. I have friends of mine sometimes, I'll never understand it. They'll be like, how was the gig? And they go, it was sucked. I'm like, how could it possibly suck? How could this gig? And they'll be like, oh, nobody danced, or nobody clapped, or nobody fucking came, or anything like that. Or the worst one is, oh, they talked over my songs. Who gives a shit, man? That's what I'm saying. And I heard this one the other day, a friend of mine, I said, how was the gig? He said, it was no good. I said, what happened? He goes, oh, they talked over all my serious shit. I said, your what? Your what stuff? He said, my serious stuff. They talked over it. I said, you've got serious stuff, man? He said, yeah. And let me tell you something, friends and neighbors, and I hear you over there, but let me tell you this. I know that there can be some joy derived from singing a sad song. It's obvious. In fact, some of the songs I sung tonight that you laughed the hardest at, if you listen real close, they're pretty goddamn sad, bordering on pathetic. So don't get me wrong. I know that some joy can be derived from singing a sad song, but a serious song, I don't know if I believe that that thing exists. A serious song, I don't know if there's room for that in humanity. Cancer, I think that's serious. Divorce, that's serious. Songs, I'm not so fucking sure. You go to see your doctor. Your doctor tells you you got 6 months to live. You go home, you put on Masters of War. You tell me it's a serious song. Because let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. Life is impossible. You want to hear a funny joke? We're dying. You want to hear an even funnier fucking joke than that? We don't know what's going to happen after that. Sure, a lot of people have their theories, and a lot of people have their philosophies. And my philosophy on theories is the same as my theory on philosophies. I think they're both fine. But the fact of the matter is that none of them ever come up with anything better than a poem to explain why we're here, what we're supposed to do while we're here, and what happens to us after we're here. You might think you know, but I'm telling you, as God is my witness, you don't. I have enjoyed sharing this complete and total lack of wisdom with you and all the chaos and confusion that it brings to us. I hope it has been as good of a distraction for you as it has been for me. In fact, I wrote a song about it. It's a very serious song, so I don't want none of you talking over it. One, two, three! If tomorrow never comes, I don't give a damn. If tomorrow never comes, I ain't gonna be afraid to meet my maker just the way that I am. You can't do anything, but one thing's true. If you can steal from me, I can steal from you. I said any kind of heaven everybody doesn't get in won't seem like heaven to me. Well, they tell you that the Garden of Eden was perfect, but you couldn't even eat off the apple tree. And for heaven's sakes, you had to watch those snakes lying to your woman constantly. Adam must have scratched his head, looked up and said, Lord, oh, this isn't doing it for me. If tomorrow never comes, tomorrow never comes, I ain't gonna be afraid to come and meet you just the way that I am. I can't do anything I'm dying to do. If tomorrow never comes tonight, I'll have to do what's it. I don't ever claim to know what's going on around here. I don't even know where I'm from. I know where I'm going when I get to where I'm going, what I'm doing when I get done. They tell me I'm forgiven if I need to be. I say permission ought to come that easily. I'm piling cores up underneath this apple tree. I'm singing, oh Lord, have mercy on me. If tomorrow never comes,
tomorrow never comes.
And then that is all I got.
Tomorrow
ever comes, I ain't gonna be afraid to meet my maker just the way I'm not. Can't do anything and then you die. Judge the judgmental and what am I? Either way, I'm every guy I've ever tried not to be. I want everything as good as it gets. I've learned nothing but that there's another sunrise coming on the one. Other times it sets, and if tomorrow never comes, well then tomorrow never comes. If tomorrow never comes, well then tomorrow never comes. If we were all good people, we could work in perfect rhythm. If worms had daggers, birds wouldn't fuck well. Thank you so much. Thanks for being so nice to us. Is it all right if I tell you one more story? It'll only take about 2 hours. Man, how many of you from East Nashville? We'll see you over at the Three Crow in a little bit. I got this old car my wife said it was okay if I got, man. It's this big, long, white convertible car from 1964. It's called a Rocket 88, and it used to be a convertible. Now they can't get the top to go up, so I don't know what you call that anymore. But one of my favorite things to do is drive this car over to the East Nashville car wash and wash it. And every time I get home from the road, I get off the plane, I go to the house, I get in this old car, I drive it over to the wash, and I wash it. It relaxes me and helps me get home. So one time I come home from the road, I get off the plane, get in the car, drive over to the East Nashville car wash. I'm washing my car, got the top down. There's a skill to it. You don't want to fuck up the interior. So I'm doing it, and here he comes, walking across the parking lot, man. Sweat beading off of his head, sweat beading down his face, sweat coming through all of his clothes. And I'm standing there, I see him coming. I feel a little threatened. I don't know what to think about. He comes over to me and says, "Hey, man, how about you give me a little money and I help you wash your car?" And I said to him, "This is actually kind of relaxing for me. How about I give you a little money and you don't help me wash my car?" And he looked at me for a second and tried to take that in, and he went, "No, I think I want to help you wash your car." And I start looking around the parking lot, and there's nobody in it but him and me, and he's a lot bigger than I am. And being a, you know, trying to be, have good judgment, I thought, fuck it, I'll let him help me. So, yeah, let's wash the car. So we start washing the car, and we're hosing it down, and we start talking about different places we live, different girls we knew, different troubles we've been in, different jobs we had. We're getting to know each other a little bit. And pretty soon the car is finished. And I'm telling you this, it's a little bit cleaner and looks a little bit better for having been washed by two guys than one. So I said, "Hey, man, I really had a good time. I'm glad you came over here and asked me if you could help." He said, "I'm glad I helped you, too." I said, "Can I ask you an honest question, though, man? When you first came over here, were you going to rob me?" And he went, "Yeah, man." And that made me scared. And so, you know, you get in fight or flight, you don't even know what you do. I don't even know why I did this. I stuck my hand out and I said, "So what's your name, man?" And he looks at me and goes, "I'm Tony Bennett." And I said, "Oh, well, I'm Bing fucking Crosby then." And he said, "Are you messing with me, man?" I said, "Am I messing with you? You started it." He said, "What do you mean I started?" I said, "You said you were Tony Bennett." I swear this happened. Who would make this up? He takes this little driver's license out of his back pocket. He shows it to me. As God is my witness, the guy's Tony Bennett. So I say, I gotta admit, I was fucking with you. I'm not really Bing Crosby. He said, I knew that you weren't. And then I said, well, I'm glad we worked this out. We hug each other and we agree we're gonna do it some other time. We hug each other and he walks off into the day. It was in that moment, though, that we hugged each other, that I think he got that $65 from me. And I think he knows that. And he knows that I know it. And the next time we see each other, we're gonna have that to talk about. A lot of my friends, when I start to tell them this story, I get to the end and they say, Todd, I thought you were talking about the Tony Bennett that left his heart in San Francisco. I'm not. I'm talking about the Tony Bennett that hangs around at the East Nashville Car Wash. And I'm sorry if there was any confusion. People treating people too bad. I say, oh, there ain't no hope. My old lady, she sure gonna be mad. Just spent the last 60 bucks that we had. Spent the last 60 bucks that we had on bad dough. East Nashville sky. Over to a state of mind, leaving all my troubles way behind. That old Cumberland River, East Nashville skyline, discount cigarettes, liquor and wine, anywhere, anytime we deliver. I'm still mad about the slow bar. That's just the way things are. Something good comes along, then it's gone. It's kind of like Phoenix Radio. We used to listen, then where did it go? It went off of the air so that more Sheryl Crow could come on. Come on! East Nashville sky. Crossing over to a state of mind, leaving all our troubles way behind. That old Cumberland River, East Nashville skyline, discount cigarettes, liquor and wine, anywhere, anytime we say that we're all wrong for these days. These days. So much for money, so much for big. Who needs the trouble? There's always a gig. There is always a gig at the cafe, the radio cafe. East Nashville sky. Crossing over to a state of mind, leaving all my troubles way behind. That old Cumberland River, East Nashville skyline, discount cigarettes, liquor and wine, anywhere, anytime we deliver.
East Nashville skyline, crossing over to a state of mind, leaving all my troubles way behind. That old Cumberland River, East Nashville skyline, discount cigarettes, liquor and wine, anywhere, anytime we deliver.
Said that the pinnacle of success is when you finally lost interest in money, compliments, and publicity. Noble enough idea, I suppose, but how on earth he does this, heaven only knows. I know I would need a lot more of all three of those before I ever had the nerve to turn up my nose at any money, compliment, some publicity. I'm broke as the Ten Commandments. Sometimes I'm harder to follow. I don't know whether to walk to school or take my lunch. Shit, I want my watch, it's true. You may think you see a man who is looking for attention, but you're looking at a man who's lived through a little bit of poverty, some anxiety, some scrutiny. I'll tell you what, if I ever do get my money together, I'm gonna take care of all my friends. I'll buy an island, run a phone line, call and tell them all to get fucked. Oh! That ought to take care of them. Just be me and my money and my compliments and my publicity. Sing it with me. Money, compliments, and publicity. It's actually an issue for me. I went to see this therapist. She said, just do the best you can do. 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 I was hoping for something more specific. Man once said that the pinnacle of success was when you'd finally lost interest in money, compliments, and publicity. Many years later, another man will say all that again, but not for the sake of inspiring men, but rather 'cause he got 9 songs and knows he needs at least 10 for he can go back to town and turn them all in to get the money. You guessed it, the compliment and the publicity. I wanna take it to the bank and save money. I love a compliment and publicity. I got so many people to thank. Hey,
compliments and publicity.
It's my buddy Elvis. Y'all feel like singing? It'd mean a lot to me if you helped me sing this one. I've been singing the whole time. It's easy to learn even if you don't. May some good fortune come to you. May some good fortune come to you. She's always cooking up something. When I'm feeling down, she knows just what to say to pull me through. Looking like Booker T and the MG sound, there ain't nothing my baby can't do. Not to change the subject, but have you seen my shoes? I think I left them here the last time I played. Sometimes I feel like all I ever get to do is lose. Sometimes I feel like I got it made. May some good fortune come to you. May some good fortune come to you.
Let's try that again all together.
May some good fortune come to you. May some good fortune. People say that life is precious and you have to make the most of it, but nobody's ever really proven either thing. And if you stand back and you look at the long and the short of it, what else is there to do but sing? May some good fortune come to you. May some good fortune come to you. Do you think there's a kid living in this entire town that is dreaming of growing up to be a bum? I didn't think you did, but we both know how that is exactly what some will become. Enough about me, though. Let's talk about you for a minute. Okay, maybe that's enough. Getting back to me, you know my all-time favorite movie is that one where those two cops who cannot stand each other later under pressure learn to work together, become great partners, even better friends. And then that one says something funny and the movie ends. May some good fortune come to you. Thank you, neighbors, for making us feel so welcome. I had a great time. I hope you got to hear the song you wanted to. God love you. Thank you. Great American Taxi. Thank you.